Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to our worship this morning for our Labor Day weekend and continuing through our season of Pentecost, growing in the teachings of our Lord Jesus Christ. Our order of service is printed in the worship folder with the music also to the hymns, as well as on our PowerPoint. We rise to start our first song, Christ Be My Leader. Let us rise.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid. That we may perfectly love you. Let us draw near to the altar of our God, to Him who is our joy and delight. We confess together. Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a troubled and sorrowful sinner, confess to you all my sins and wrongdoing with which I have offended you, and for which I justly deserve your punishment. When I am sincerely sorry for them, and repent of them, and pray for your boundless mercy, for the sake of the suffering and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Forgive my sins, give me your Holy Spirit for the renewal and changing of my sinful life, and bring me to everlasting life. Amen. With mercy and compassion, our God blesses you. By the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I, as a called and ordained servant of the Word, forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
O Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, have mercy. Hear us and give us your peace. Amen.
Glory be to God in heaven, peace, goodwill to all the earth. Mighty God of all creation, Father of servants. surpassing worth. We exalt you, we adore you, we lift high our thanks and praise. Saints and angels bow before you, here on earth our songs we raise. Glory be to Christ forever, Lamb of God and Lord of love, Son of God and gracious Savior, you have come from heaven above. On the cross you died to save us, now you reign at God's right hand. Hear our prayer, restore, forgive us. In your promise firm we stand. Holy One, we now acclaim you, Lord, alone to you we call. Holy One, in faith we name you, God Most High, yet near to all. Jesus Christ, with God the Spirit, in the Father's splendor bright. For the peace that we inherit, glory be to God on high.
We pray. Direct us, O Lord God, in all our doings with your continual help, that in all our works, begun, continued, and ended in you, we may glorify your name, and finally, by your mercy, bring us to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Reading comes from Deuteronomy chapters 30, verses 15 to 20. See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I command you today, by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways, and keeping his commandments and his statutes and his rules, then you shall live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to take possession of it. But if your heart turns away, and you will not hear, but are drawn away to worship other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are going over the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessing and curse. Therefore, choose life, that you and your offspring may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying his voice, and holding fast to him. For he is your life and length of days, that you may dwell in the land that the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Epistle comes from Philemon, verses 1 to 21. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved fellow worker, and Apphia, our sister, and Acrippus, our fellow soldier, and the church in your house, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God always when I remember you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of the faith that you have toward Lord Jesus and for all the saints. And I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective for the knowledge of every good thing that is in us for the sake of Christ. I have derived much joy and comfort from your love, my brother, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you. Accordingly, though I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do what is required, yet for love's sake I prefer to appeal to you. I, Paul, an old man, now a prisoner also for Christ Jesus, I appeal to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I became in my imprisonment. Formerly he was useless to you, but now he is indeed useful to you and to me. I am sending him back to you, sending my very heart. I would have been glad to keep him with me in order that he might serve me on your behalf during my imprisonment for the gospel, but I prefer to do nothing without your consent in order that your goodness might not be by compulsion, but of your own accord. For this, perhaps, is why he was parted from you for a while, that you might have him back forever, no longer as bondservant, but more than bondservant, as beloved brother, especially to me, how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, receive him as you would receive me. If he has wronged you at all or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repay it, to say nothing of your own owing me even at your own self. Yes, brother, I want some benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ, confident of your obedience. I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. This is the word of the Lord.
Verses 25 to 35. Glory to you, O Lord. Now great crowds accompanied Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, desiring to build a tower, does not first sit down and count the cost, whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, 'This man began to build and was not able to finish.' Or what king, going out to encounter another king in war, will not sit down first and deliberate whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? And if not, while the other is yet a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. So therefore, any of you who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is of no use either for the soil or for the manure pile. It is thrown away. He who has ears to hear, let him hear." This is the gospel of the Lord. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We continue now with our sermon hymn, I Call You to My Father's House, and you may be seated. May God fill you all with great hope and joy and peace in your believing. Amen. The message today for the 13th Sunday after Pentecost is from Luke's Gospel, chapter 14, when we're called to be a disciple and we must hate and disown various things. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Most of us have grown up hearing a time or two, whether in church or out of church, God is love. It's on greeting cards, church signs, Sunday school songs, and even bumper stickers. It's true. God is love. And it's actually, statistically, something most people need to hear more often than they do, that their God loves them. Today's gospel, though, sounds a little more like God is hate. Hate is harder to hear. And it's not the opposite of love as we often think. That would be indifference, not really caring, losing all sorts of interest in life or the other person. But if love is sort of a good passion, hate is a negative passion. Hate has a whole new revived place even in our world and our culture today. It's talked about in politics, in the entertainment world, almost every corner of life. There are laws against speaking or writing hate speech. And I can understand wanting to outlaw hate because it is so destructive. But nothing in this life we do will fully ever stop hatred. As we know, our Lord Jesus Christ already took care of that, paying the price for hate with his own death. His cross is his wisdom, where he shows us love. And he gives us his Holy Spirit to lead us into love and show us how to love and how to hate. Yes, how to hate. The crowds around Jesus are still too much in love with what happened, about what he's always then producing for them
as far as healing and miracles and food. They liked the celebrity status he brings. But Jesus' disciples and us today see and hear this, so he must set us all straight. Following him around will end up in some kind of suffering. Jesus will cause many to hate. All of us somehow prepare for times of suffering. We know we'll face it. There's all kinds of hurts and disappointments in this life. So, he starts with hating family. Hate parents, hate our spouse, hate our kids, hate what we love most dearly to follow Jesus. Now, I thought Jesus was all about love too. And doesn't he love the human family? Hate even your own life? I thought we're supposed to love ourselves like we love our neighbor. But hating, in terms of understanding it the way we know it, really involves quite a passionate detest and a strong dislike for someone or something, eradicating anything apprehensible or evil from our lives. Hate can even mean wanting somebody dead. But in the ancient world, it was looked upon a little differently. Hating one's family was totally unique. Hating here means you're causing them public disgrace, because in a way where name and reputation means everything, following some sort of rabbi around could cause public embarrassment, and that was a death sentence. Life is family-centered, and the honor of the family is of prime importance. Honor must be held as sacred by every member of that family. Total loyalty, total trust, total unity. Moving around as a group, and no one can break that bond, because life in the ancient world was not easy. So you needed each other for all sorts of protection. If some family members joined a strange movement, like Jesus is talking about here, and abandoned their home or family, it brings disgrace. It's a little unusual for us to kind of comprehend today. Our kids grow up, they go to school, they get jobs, sometimes move away. It's how things often go. But families then didn't do that. That would have been like having today your kids follow like a crazy cult leader like Jim Jones of 40 years ago, and they do strange things and wind up dead in the end. That would be more the equivalent of what these ancient families were looking at. New religious movements popped up all the time in those days and always divided families. Think of those who followed that austere character, John the Baptizer, around. Letters still survive to this day where Roman families complain that their children ran off and became involved with a group of Christians. But Jesus' saying is still hard, and it's still all-encompassing. And journeying in this world with Jesus must be our first priority. And that starts with ourself. Hating one's own self means that we're disconnecting from everything that had previously defined us as a person. A person's past no longer defines who they are. Our identity is no longer formed by one's former allegiances, nor one's experiences in life, even one's human origin. That's part of the old way of looking at the world. But Jesus gives way to the new world of his Father's kingdom. His disciple must not be defined by the past, but by their work in the present, building the future hope. Now, it doesn't mean we can't have an identity outside of our baptismal calling as Christians, but it means our identity as Jesus' disciple is what really matters. So if we sit down reasonably and tally the costs, as Jesus suggests that we do, it's really quite reasonable not to choose to follow Christ, actually, at least from an economic and cultural standpoint. But in Jesus, math and economics sort of fail. Following Christ is never a numbers game. It's not a question of giving up one thing like family, friends, possessions in order to get something from God in return. It is not tit for tat. It's not a favor system. Jesus has something quite different in mind. You still have all those other things. You still are who you are. You still have your jobs and your families and your life. No one is called to live alone like a monk or a nun. But Christ is calling you into a cross way of life, to bear the cross, and you're his disciple. And crosses kill. They torture criminals to death. So to take up your cross is to take up your death. You can't follow Jesus without that cross, and death is a reality
before any hope of a resurrected new life comes. That didn't even enter any of their minds that particular day, I'm sure. It's hard getting past that death part, that hate part, that getting rid of things. And it stands to reason that if you can't die, you can't rise. And if you can't rise, well, you're stuck in that unredeemable mess. Following Jesus now sounds dangerous, even deadly, and it is. But we don't want to misunderstand hating one's own life and family or putting the world in a category we can't ever enter into. It's really rearranging priorities and loyalties. Humanly speaking, we want to love our possessions and the people in our lives because we get something out of it. That's the sinful human side. But we're also, at the same time, called to be good caretakers of what we have, including those we love. Life in God's eyes isn't supposed to be transactional. That's not how He made us, and that's not truly love. So we hate those things only to love them better, more freely. Jesus is the first place we have in our life, and from that placement, we can and do love other things in freedom and joy and abundance. You can easily hate your sinful life because you love Christ and desire what He desires and what He does for your life, which begins and ends with Him. And that is a gift as well, because we can only truly love people when we first love God and His Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus doesn't even tell us that we'll receive different or better families or greater things. We'll just receive more. There's abundance in Christ. There is plenty. There's not scarcity and loss. And that's a new way of looking at life, because you're connected to something bigger, to the kingdom to which Jesus promises those very same families will be actually invited to be a part of. Families and possessions get cared for best when they revolve around God. So do count the cost. Do the math. Calculate the loyalties. Like when you're at the gas station and you always have to pay first before fueling. You got to figure out how much to buy before you fill the tank. You set out to build something, you got to make sure you have the money to do it. Otherwise, it'll never get done. Or when armies go into battle, you count the cost of war. Can it be affordable? Can it be won? Will I ever get out of this thing? Or will I have to keep admitting more and more and then lose and have to make peace fast? Many of our decisions are economic, more than anything else. Can we afford most of the things we have in this life? Will they break the bank? Is there going to be enough money? We make important choices in our lives by counting the cost, and we'd be fools, in a sense, if we didn't. But what's hard about following Jesus is that it costs everything, because our own dear life is everything we have. I love Dietrich Bonhoeffer, and his Cost of Discipleship is a wonderful book. One of the first books I read into when I went into the ministry, and I read it here and there every year since. And the most simply beautiful part is when he writes that when Jesus calls us, he's always bidding us to come and die. It's a daily dying. It's a daily rising, because every day is a new day, a new start. The old is taken away and the new is given. Truth be told, if you really counted the cost, you'd never come to church or to baptism. You'd never trust Christ, never follow him, because it's not something we can easily see. No one would believe it. But that's why God doesn't make following Jesus a choice. No one would ever choose it. We don't want to take up a cross willingly. No one wants to die before living. No one wants to love God and his Son first and then trust that all the work that is in us through Christ and his Spirit and loving our families will happen in the best way. Nobody waits for that to happen. We see death and we want to run the other way. But the cross, the death, the rearranging of priorities, that is given. That isn't a choice. It is placed upon us when we're marked with Christ in baptism. And it's that washing away of sin and the new birth that we're reminded of by the Holy Spirit that gives birth to this new way of life. That is why Jesus goes to the cross in the first place. There's not a single human being alive who'd be willing to take up a cross and follow and die for the world. He takes on that cost. He dies the cost of discipleship and entry into the kingdom of grace by dying. He lays down his life to save everyone. He becomes the world's sin, dying our death, and he counted the cost for sure of being the world's savior. Jesus counted the cost of rescuing you from sin and death. and it was worth every drop of his holy, precious blood to save you. He gave up everything that's his honor, his glory, his dominion, his power, his entire life for the joy of your salvation. And he took it up on the cross and gives you in return life. He didn't ask you to choose him, he chose you. He put you on the path of life before you even knew it was happening. Before you believed, before you were born, before you ever were, Christ was your Savior and Lord. And even if you came to faith later as an adult or sought out baptism later or came to Holy Communion much later than the usual ages of confirmation, you still didn't choose him. He chose you. He made your life path twist and turn right back to Jesus. He laid his cross on you, not to kill you physically, but to bring you new life. People do want the most out of life, and our God doesn't ever begrudge that. That's important to remember. Life has work and dignity and value, but the most we want out of life begins by believing that nothing on earth can offer the most. The most and best comes from Christ, and he is in us through faith. Because this way of Jesus will cause some measure of suffering, and Jesus makes us salt in the world. It gives flavor, it preserves, it heals, and it even hurts, like salt in wounds. But salt is the way Jesus brings about healing, and he makes that way for us. And we will see every other person out there beyond these walls in need of our love because of Christ. And it's all by the gift of grace that we are free in Christ to see it this way. And it isn't a cheap grace. It isn't wasteful grace. It is free grace. Free to you, costly to Christ. But good thing he pays the cost in full. And by learning how to hate now, we truly learn how to love. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which goes beyond our human understanding, guard your hearts and lives in the one true faith in Jesus Christ, now and always. Amen. We now gather the offering.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people as they have needs. For the faithful preaching and teaching of the gospel, that we may never depart from the eternal truth of Christ crucified, let us pray to the Lord. For Christ's holy church here and throughout the world, for all who hear the word of God and are brought to renewal and faith, and for grace that God's people may be sustained in his word, drawing strength in times of persecution, let us pray to the Lord. For this congregation, for the work of God's kingdom that goes forth from this baptismal font, altar, and pulpit, and for those who serve us in Christ's name here and throughout the world, let us pray to the Lord. For a faithful and fruitful life of prayer, praying not only for our needs, but praying his promises that our hearts may rest in his perfect peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the government of our land, for leaders of our nation, for godly lives as citizens, for those who protect and defend our country both here and abroad, and for good government and secure people everywhere, let us pray to the Lord. For honest labor, for all worthy occupations, and for the culture and enrichment of the arts and service to God, that he may prosper them for our benefit and allow us to share of their fruits, let us pray to the Lord. For those in any need, especially that the sick may be healed, the grieving comforted, and the dying consoled, we especially remember Sarah Eggert, Helen Shook, Glenn Pink's brother Steve, Janine, Maureen Amu's father Sheldon, Bill Sowry, Amelia, David and Catherine McBride, Harper, Sue Moskal, Bill Dula, Tom Saxton, Pastor Frank and Mary Silver, Eric and Deanna, Eric Bodner, Jeff and Sue Noel, all our shut-in members, Pauline and Mona, John and Lois, Lorraine and Emily, all students and learners returning to classrooms this week after a time of vacation, and for safety, all travelers in this Labor Day weekend. And that God may give them all things good and necessary to them in their time of need. Let us pray to the Lord. For the faithful who have gone before us with the sign of faith and now rest from their labors, that we may be brought with them to the grace of everlasting life. And finally, gracious God, bring us at last through all trials and deliver us into your kingdom without end, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And in our closing prayer, we pray together. Lord Jesus Christ, our guide and our goal, keep our eyes fixed on you. Encourage us to persevere in running the race that you have set before us, and strengthen us to overcome all obstacles. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us praise the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We close with our last song, Jesus is Lord of All.
Jesus is Lord of all.
You may be seated. I'd like to extend a warm and gracious welcome to all of you gathering for our worship this morning on this Labor Day weekend. Is there any announcement that has to be made with the yard sale? I know there's some new announcements going out. Anything you need to elaborate or announce? Everything, I guess, is self-explanatory in our worship folder. The only thing I want to remind folks about is my family and I next week won't be here for the Sunday. Pastor John will be leading service. Grace Lutheran Church in Niagara Falls, New York, has their 115th church anniversary, and I was their field worker for about 3 years and still have close ties to Reverend Breeze, who was there and is part of the service, and we're going to be attending that next Sunday, same time, I believe, as our own church service here. But I'll be certainly here for this week and then the coming weeks. So let us go then in God's grace, serving our Lord in peace and joy. Thanks be to God. Good morning, Peter and Tom. Good morning, Pearl. How are you? It probably has faded already, but it comes quick and leaves quick. Morning, how are you doing, Garth? Thanks. Morning.